Hello everyone. So today we will going to learn the performance of boiler. So I know this is not the right way for the elaborations of the expressions, because too much time would be consumed if I would have gone through the original technique like I did in case of the previous video session. So that's why I have prepared the notes first. Okay, so this is my notes on boiler. Okay. So we have an idea about the boiler. The boiler is a system which transfers the energy from the fuel to water, as we all know. Now, the performance of boiler can be assessed by the following parameters. Okay. Now, what are these parameters? So first one is evaporation. Equivalent evaporation, boiler thermal efficiency, and last but not the least, losses of heat in a boiler plant. Okay, so let's begin the show with first one, evaporation. Now the evaporation, or you can say evaporative capacity of boiler, so normally this is depends upon the grat area, means the amount of fuel the boiler can consume. And number two, the heating surface, that is the quantity of heat the boiler can absorb. Okay, now, so as you can read easily, that the quantity of steam generated by a boiler per hour in kg at full load is known as the evaporative capacity of the boiler. Okay, now, the generation rate can be expressed on the basis of grat area, so as I told you earlier, or furnace volume, or fuel burned. Okay, so in a single sentence we can say the evaporation rate is the ratio of total steam generated to the area of grat. Okay, or that it is the ratio of total steam generated the total steam generated to the volume of the furnace, or you can say it is the ratio of the total steam generated to the total fuel burned. Okay, now if we consider that total steam generated is denoted by M suffix S and area of grat obviously in terms of area A. Okay, so it is in kg per hour, means amount of steam generated per kg, in kg per hour, and area in meter square. Okay, so, or in terms of volume of furnace, that is per meter cube, and the total quantity of fuel burned, that is MF. Okay, now, so this evaporation capacity of the boiler is the main specification necessary for the design for the grat, furnace, heating surface, or other components. Okay. Now coming to the next point. So though this is not a perfect calculation. Okay. Now coming to the next point. So next point is equivalent evaporation. So we need to know what is equivalent evaporation, why this term comes. Now when boilers are generating steam under different working conditions, so like different pressure, different quality, or different temperature of feed water, so assuming all other conditions are same. Okay, the capacity comparison is based done by comparing the amount of heat added in each boiler for steam generation. So this is only done by defining equivalent evaporation. Now what is equivalent evaporation? So the quantity of dry saturated steam, So later on I will tell you what is the meaning of dry saturated steam. Okay, that could be generated by the boiler per unit time from water at 100 degree centigrade. Okay, that is the boiling point of the water. Okay, so at a pressure corresponding to the 100 degree centigrade, so this is the saturation temperature. So this is known as equivalent evaporation. Okay. Now the quantity of heat supplied to the boiler to evaporate 1 kg of water to 1 kg of steam at its boiling point or saturation temperature is 2257 kilojoule, or you can say 2260 kilojoule. Okay, so this is the latent heat of steam. Okay, and it is expressed in kilojoule per kg. Okay, so now consider a boiler generating mskg of steam per hour. So at any instant pressure, say P, and temperature T, so from water with enthalpy HF1. Okay, with enthalpy HF1. So later on I tell you, so what is enthalpy. Now coming to the next page. So let HS, H suffix S, be the enthalpy of steam per kg under the generating conditions. So now you can see three different types of expressions. Okay, so now unless and until if you do not have the idea about the steam, you wouldn't be able to understand these expressions. Okay. Now coming to the steam, so I think you would have a very good idea about the steam. So what is a steam? Steam is a vapor of water, and so it is invisible when it is pure or dry. Okay, now it is used as a working substance in the operation of steam engines and normally steam turbines. Okay, these are the major areas where we can use the steam. Now steam does not obey the laws of the perfect gases until it is perfectly dry. Okay, so now when the dry vapor is heated further, means once we heat the steam, once we heat the water, it will be converted into steam or dry vapor. Now once the dry vapor is heated further, so it becomes superheated vapor, so which behaves more or less so like a perfect gas. Okay, now we need to know what is superheated steam. Okay, so before that we need to know what is what are the classification of steam. So steam can be classified into normally three categories. So first one is wet steam, second one is dry steam, and third one is the superheated steam. Okay, now we need to know the definitions of these three. Okay, I'm trying to brief it. So when the steam contains moisture, or you can say particles of water in suspension, it is said to be wet steam. It means that the evaporation of water is not complete yet. Okay, and the whole of the latent heat has not been absorbed. Okay, so then what is dry steam? So dry steam can also be stated as dry saturated steam. Okay, so I'm telling you why it is so called saturated. So dry steam means when the wet steam is further heated and it does not contain any suspended particles of water. Okay, so it will be known as dry steam, or you can say dry saturated steam. Okay, means the dry steam has absorbed its full latent heat and behaves perfectly in the same way as a perfect gas. Okay, and if the dry steam is further heated at a constant pressure, okay, and its temperature is rising continuously, then it will be said as superheated steam. Okay, means from the boiler normally superheated steam is generated and it will stuck the turbine vanes, okay, for the speed generation or for the increase in speed of turbine, okay, so we are, because of the power generation. So I think you are having a good idea about the steams. So now, so let me show you. So before coming these three, okay, let me show you. How the steam form. Okay. Now the formation of steam. Wait for a bit. Okay. Now the formation of steam is like, suppose we are going to plot a graph. Okay, so it is the graph of temperature to, you can say, enthalpy. Temperature versus enthalpy. Now before plotting the curve, we need to know what is enthalpy. So enthalpy is expressed by it is the summation of internal energy, that is expressed by U, internal energy, to the product of pressure and volume of a gas. So H can be expressed as the summation of internal energy with the product of pressure and volume. Okay, pressure and volume, it is known as enthalpy. Now the unit of enthalpy is same as the unit of heat, so it is expressed in kilojoule or joule. Okay, now once it is divided by mass, once the h is divided by mass m, it will be known as, or the whole equation is known divided by the mass. Okay, the left hand side and right hand side both divided by mass, so h will be small h, u will be small u, p will be unaltered, and v by m will be small v. Now in this time, this h is known as the specific enthalpy that we are going to plot. Okay, u will be specific internal energy and it is specific volume. We cannot say it is specific pressure, okay, because in thermodynamics there are two types of properties, intensive properties, extensive properties. So I don't think you have read this. Okay. So now, forget about thermodynamics. Okay. Now the coming to the point. So this is the expressions of enthalpy. Okay. Now, so you can say the abscissa represents the total heat, and the ordinate represents the temperature. Okay. Now what will happen? So suppose. Okay, suppose a piece of ice of temperature, suppose 20 degree centigrade. So here the temperature is 20 degree centigrade. Now if
we are going to increase the heat. Increase the heat. Now 20 degree centigrade will be coming to, suppose 0 degree centigrade. Okay. 0 degree centigrade. Okay. Now, so it does not change its state. So at 20 degree centigrade, it was ice. At 0 degree centigrade, it is still ice. So now, if we are going to increase the heat by keeping temperature as constant. Suppose this is our TS diagram, this diagram. So this is the original diagram, and this is the diagram of conversions from water to steam, and this is the conversion of ice to steam. Okay. Now, if so, keeping temperature as constant, so here we can observe the phase will be changed. Phase change means from 0 degree centigrade ice, it will be converted into 0 degree centigrade water. Okay, so look here. So we have increased the heat. Okay, but we did not change the temperature. Now, with the change of temperature, so from 0 degree centigrade, if we can achieve the 100 degree centigrade, so from here to here, so water will be water, but the temperature varies, means the phase does not change, but the temperature changes. So look here, temperature is suppose T degree centigrade, or here temperature is suppose 0 degree centigrade, here the temperature is T degree centigrade. Okay, T degree centigrade. Now again, if we are keeping the temperature as constant and increasing the heat, now the 100 degree centigrade water means at this point the water starts boiling. Okay, so now, so if we are keeping the temperature as constant and increasing the heat from here to here, okay, so we can observe the total amount of water will be converted into fully steam. So now at this point, so water does not, or water vapor does not contain any water particles. Okay, means the vapor from this point does not contain any water particles. Okay, at this point. So at this point we can say the steam is totally dry steam. And before that, from this point to this point, we can say the steam is wet steam. Okay, now after reaching at this point, we can say the steam is dry steam. Okay, now after this point, if we are going to increase the heat again and also increase the temperature, okay, so at any certain points we will get a steam nature of superheated, means at this point we will have a superheated steam, means that is the more achievable to us. Okay, at this point the superheated steam will be behave like an ideal gas. Okay, so this is the actual TH diagram. This is the actual TH diagram. Okay, now at this point the temperature is known as superheated temperature, T superheated, and this temperature in this curve, this temperature is known as saturated temperature. Okay, means on further heating, the water particle in suspension will be converted into steam in this line. Okay, and the entire steam in such a state is termed as the dry steam, or you can say the saturated steam. Okay, and on further heating, the temperature of the steam starts rising, and the steam in such state is termed as the superheated steam. Okay, now so plotting this one, so plotting this curve, how the curve of TH, temperature enthalpy, so curve will be look like this side.
sorry, this side. Okay, so suppose this point is this point, okay, 100 degrees. This point is this point. So if a category known as, suppose this one is A, B, C, D, salient points, E and F. So this is our D point, this is E point, this is F point. So normally this is not a straight line, this will be curved, parabolic line, curved, okay, F point. Okay, and suppose this point is this is a anatep like this, and this is C point. Okay, so C, D, E, F. This is the formation of steam from water. So here it is water. It is water. Okay, so formation of steam from water to superheated steam. Okay. Now this is known as vapor dome. Vapor dome. So at the peak point, this point is known as the critical point. Critical point. Okay. So here the pressure is almost 374. Something degree centigrade. Okay. And the critical pressure is 221.2 bar at this point. Okay. Means at this point, so both the liquid and vapor, liquid and vapor phases become identical, okay, in every respect. Okay, in every respect, this line is known as, from this point to this point, left hand side curvature line is known as saturated liquid line, and the right hand side curvature line is known as saturated vapor line. Okay, see, unless and until you don't have an idea about the steam, you wouldn't be able to understand these. Okay, so now from C to D, this heat is known as sensible heat. From D to E, this heat, this amount of heat is known as latent heat, LH. And from E to F, this amount of heat is known as heat of superheat. Okay, so SH plus LH plus HS is the total amount of heat. Okay, or you can say it is the total enthalpy. Okay, now what is a sensible heat? So sensible heat is the amount of heat absorbed by 1 kg of water when heated at a constant pressure. So from the freezing point to the temperature of formation of steam, means in this diagram, so A to D, this horizontal line, okay, from freezing point to the temperature of formation of steam. So from here the steam is about to form from water to steam, okay, or about to convert, okay. So this temperature of formation of steam is known as the saturation temperature. Okay, and the sensible heat, the sensible heat is also known as the liquid heat. Okay, now how to calculate the liquid heat? So it is as we know almost, so the heat equals to MST. Okay, so M is supposed to be 1. If M is supposed to be 1, so specific heat of water is as you all know, 4.2 kilojoule per kg Kelvin, and the rise of temperature, okay, and the rise in temperature. Okay, this is how we can calculate the sensible heat. Now, what is latent heat? So, latent heat is the amount of heat, or latent heat we have just studied earlier. Okay, what is latent heat? So, then also I can repeat it for you. So, latent heat is the amount of heat absorbed to evaporate 1 kg of water at its boiling point or saturation temperature without the temperature change. Okay, now latent heat, this portion is known as HFG. Here, this is enthalpy of fluid and gas. HFG means D2E. This portion is mixed with water vapor. You can say water vapor. Okay, so here the steam will contain the water particle, also the air particle or vapor. Okay, from C to D, this portion is contained only enthalpy of fluid. So C to D, you can say it is H of fluid, enthalpy of fluid. From C to D region, we can be able to get enthalpy of fluid. From D to E, or D to before reaching of E point, okay, we'll have HFG. So what is HFG? HFG is the Hg minus HF. HFG is known as Hg minus HF. Okay. And from this E to F region, so from E to F region, now the nature of steam will be superheated. Okay, now E to F region, it will be, if the pressure remains constant, Cp into T of superheated, at this point maximum temperature minus T of saturation, means temperature of this one, corresponding temperature of E. Okay, this will be known as the specific enthalpy during or in between E to F zone, specific enthalpy. Okay, that's why so M is absent. Okay, so it's specific enthalpy. These are also specific enthalpies. Okay, now, so where we can say or how to calculate the total heat of steam. Now, total heat of steam means we are just coming to this point. Total heat of steam, if it is supposed to be expressed in terms of H, so H will be known as total heat of steam. So for wet steam, for wet steam means from C point to before reaching of E points. So steam is found as wet steam, as I have stated earlier. Okay, wet steam means steam is containing still water particles. So from C to D point, it is known as HF plus, here is a factor, XHFG. So X is known as the dryness fraction. So what is dryness fraction? So dryness fraction, dryness fraction X is the mass of the dry steam to, you can say mass of the wet steam. So mass of the dry steam to the mass of the wet steam, and MF is the mass of the water in suspension. Okay, so X is mg by mg plus MF. Okay, so if x is 1, the steam will be known as the dry saturated steam. Okay, and the value of x is always less than 1 for wet steam. Means if value of x exists and it is lies less than 1, means the property of steam will be wet steam. Okay, for wet steam, so look this. So HS means, so amount of steam supplied, that is for S. Okay, so enthalpy of steam per kg under the generating conditions. So HS can be expressed as HF plus X HFG. So for wet steam with dryness fraction 1. Okay, now, now for dry saturated steam, this X will be 1. Means look here,
x found. If we are going to put the value of x over here, 1 means hs will be equals to ha plus hfg. So as we have stated earlier, now the hfg can be written as hg minus hf, means so hf ha will be cancel out and hs will be equals to ag, means enthalpy of dry saturated steam. And the enthalpy of the superheated steam means, so from C point to D point in enthalpy gained by the steam is, so this is C point to E point. Okay, now so E and F, this will be, so just add this much part, Cp T, sorry, now you can see it, Cp T superheated minus T saturation. Okay, and as it is superheated steam, x will be 1. As it is, x will be 1. Now hf plus hfg, it will be hg plus cp into T superheated minus T saturation. So now you can be able to understand this one. Okay, so in three category, so heat can be supplied. If the heat supplied through the wet steam, expression will be this one. Through the dry steam, expression will be this one. And through the superheated steam, this is the desirable. So HS equals to HF plus HFG means AG plus CP T superheated minus T saturation. Okay, this is for superheated steam. Now then, the heat gained by the steam for the boiler per unit time. Okay, per unit time, it will be known as MS into HS minus HF1. So HS is the enthalpy of steam and HF1 was the enthalpy of the feed water. Okay, so it is kilojoule per hour. Okay, look, so per unit time, so it is kilojoule. So it is enthalpy is kilojoule per kg multiplied by kg, it will be kilojoule per hour. Okay, now the equivalent evaporation from the definition is obtained as it can be denoted by E. Okay, it is obtained as MS into HS minus HF1 divided the enthalpy of the water, means heat absorbed to evaporate 1 kg of water at its boiling point, that is latent heat. Okay, so it is kg per hour, or it can be expressed in kg per kg of fuel, means it is having more than one unit. Okay, equivalent evaporation. Okay, so like previous one, the evaporative rate, so that was also having kg per hour per meter square, or kg per hour per meter cube, or kg per kg of fuel. Okay, now so now you are having an idea about the equivalent evaporation. Now coming to the third point, so third point is very vital. So it is the boiler thermal efficiency. It is the ratio of heat absorbed by the steam from the boiler per unit time to the heat liberated or heat supplied by the combustion of fuel in the furnace during the same time. Okay, so I don't think there would not be any doubts in the definition of thermal efficiency. It is the ratio of heat absorbed to the heat supplied. So means, so this was the amount of heat absorbed. Okay, and heat supplied, like the same as we did in case of the ice engine, amount of heat supplied. So MF into CV, where MF. So MF, you can see over here. So mf is the mass of the fuel burned in kg per hour, while the ms is the mass of the steam generated in kg per hour. Okay, and mf into cv is the heat supplied by the fuel. Okay, and cv is the calorific value of fuel. Okay, so the thermal efficiency is, so ms by mf, so means mass of the steam supplied by mass of the fuel, it is known as m. So m is the steam generated per kg of fuel, steam generated per kg of fuel. Okay, and multiplied by 100%, we will have the thermal efficiency. Now if the boiler, economizer and superheater are considered as a single unit, then the boiler efficiency is termed as the overall efficiency of the boiler plant. Okay. Now coming to the last but not the least and most vital point is the heat losses in a boiler plant. Means where the loss factor comes into play. Okay. Or loss factor played a vital role. Means where we can say the heats are losses. Okay. Now in various ways in which heat is lost in boiler power plant. Okay. Now where we can say the heat lost. The first one is heat lost to flue gases, means which is usually escaping from the chimney towards the atmosphere or to the atmosphere. Okay. Now so amount of heat lost to the dry flue gases, okay, you can see gases is expressed as Q1 equals to mg cpg, then temperature of gas minus atmospheric temperature in kilojoule. Okay, now mg is the mass of gases formed per kg of fuel, cpg is the specific heat of gases, tg is the temperature of gases in degree centigrade, and ta is the temperature of air, that is atmospheric temperature, so entering air entering the combustion chamber. Okay, now second one is now heat carried by the steam in flue gases, means amount of heat carried out by the steam in flue gases. Okay, it is expressed as Q2 is equals to MS1 multiplied by HS minus H suffix W. Now where MS1 is the mass of steam formed per kg of fuel due to the combustion of H2. This is very, very important as the hydrogen present within the combustion chamber. Okay, in the fuel. Okay, as a presence of fuel, presence of H2 in fuel, so MS1 comes. Okay, and HS is the enthalpy of steam raised, and HW is the enthalpy of feed water, means the water is feeding inside the boiler. Okay, now third point is, through moisture how much heat is lost, means the heat loss to the moisture in the flue gases and to water vapors formed from the combustion of hydrogen. So it is expressed in Q3. Okay, so now flue gas temperature for superheated steam state is Q3 equals to, so 9 times of H2 plus mass of moisture mm multiplied by HS minus HW. Okay, so this can be expressed in the, okay, this way. So as it is a superheated steam state, so HS can be expressed as, so HA plus HFG means HG plus CPS and TG. So TG means superheated temperature, and TS is the saturation temperature. Okay. So here you can see. So 9H2 plus mm equals to the mass. These are the empirical formulas, means which can be stated but cannot proved. Okay. So mass of steam formed per kg of fuel. So where H2 is the mass of hydrogen per kg of fuel. Okay. mm is the mass of moisture present per kg of fuel. CPS is the, C suffix PS is the specific heat of superheated steam. And HW is the enthalpy of feed water or water at the boiler room temperature. Okay, means at the temperature in which the boiler is working or a boiler is located, boiler room temperature. Okay. Now last point, fourth point, heat loss due to the incomplete combustion. So what is incomplete combustion? We need to know. Now the incomplete combustion means if the carbon burns into CO instead of CO2, then it is known as incomplete combustion. Okay, so incomplete combustion implies that the fuel burns to CO instead of CO2. Means the CO2 would be the actual what we can say. Chemical factor which should be formed after combustion. If combustion is complete, if it is incomplete, then CO will be coming out instead of CO2. Okay. Now, where is the loss found? So when 1 kg of carbon is burned to CO2, means carbon is converted into CO2. 33,830, it is an approximate value, okay, kilojoule of heat is released. But when 1 kg of carbon is burned to carbon monoxide CO, then only 10,130, or you can say 10,200 kilojoule, so it is also an approximate value of heat is released. Means look, here is a loss. Okay, so as such, the heat lost due to the incomplete combustion of 1 kg of carbon is, look, this amount. Okay, now, so from the volumetric analysis of dry flue gases, means volumetric analysis can be done with the help of the Orsted apparatus. Okay, so from the volumetric analysis of dry flue gases, the mass of carbon burned to CO can be equals to CO into carbon divided by CO2 plus CO. Okay, so this can be achieved by unitary method. Okay, so from CO2 plus CO, CO2 plus CO formed after burning the carbon, and if we burn, or CO formed from how much quantity of carbon burned. Okay, this one. Now, so heat lost due to the incomplete combustion of carbon per kg of fuel is expressed in this way. Okay, so where C is the fraction of carbon in 1 kg of fuel, and CO and CO2 are the percentages by volume of carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide in the dry flue gases. Okay. Now, now amount of heat lost due to the unburned fuel means if the fuel is not burned, then what amount of heat will be lost? So look, this loss occurs due to the unburned carbon particles that falls through the grad bars.
grad bars means above the means grad is a what we can say grad is a is an element or object so above which the combustion occurs. Okay, it is not grad level. Okay, so do not mix concept. Okay, and it is expressed as Q5 equals to MC into CV. So just like MF into CV, heat supplied. Similarly, MC into CV, where MC is the unburnt mass of carbon per kg of fuel, and CV is the calorific value of carbon. Okay, as simple as that. Now, last point is very, very important. So here is another point, but we did not mention in the copy. That is the convection and radiation loss. As you can see at the last point, convection and radiation loss. Now, so I can sort it out within 1 minute. Okay. Suppose the hot surfaces of boiler so is totally exposed to the atmosphere, right? And therefore, so heat is lost to the atmosphere by convection and radiation. Okay. Now, this heat loss cannot be calculated by any measurement. Right? Now, this difference is accounted for as heat loss by convection and radiation. Okay? Means the heat unaccounted for. Means, so what amount of heat we cannot calculate. Okay? So look, if it is expressed by Q6, it is heat supplied in fuel, it is the difference of heat supplied in fuel minus all the losses and all the uses, okay, or utilization of heat. Okay, now so heat can be utilized from Q1 to Q5. Okay, now Q minus summation of Q1 to Q5. Now this unaccounted heat means the remaining value of heat or remaining portion of heat, okay, is normally taken as the heat lost due to the convection and radiation. Okay, now this heat lost or this heat loss due to convection and radiation is can be reduced actually by providing the heating insulation on the boiler surface, right? So the last part means point number 4 is totally the heat balance sheet, you can say. It is heat balance sheet. Means in the heat balance sheet we can be able to easily show where we can use the heat or what amount of heat has been supplied and what are the utilizations of heat and where the heat is lost. Okay, so this is the boiler performance, or these are the expressions of boiler performance. Okay, and heat balance sheet can be shown by forming a table. Okay, so that I will show you later on. Okay, how it is drawn. Okay, so till now, thank you.